me afano, ni siento derrotado, ni nada. Espero que pasen los tiempos, llegará el momento. Ahí sí me levanto. Ya de mi nacimiento fui, de pronto fui así simple. Quieren, no quieren, o quieren también, pero no. No me presento que soy el número uno, yo tengo que ser el primero, ¿no? También hay otro punto que he aprendido, que si cada uno tiene su nombre, cuando lo llama, parece. Ponte y vaya. Y eso soy. Me siento como siempre. Me siento como que arrinconado, pero estoy pendiente mentalmente. Para reír soy el último. Pero cuando me río sabroso.
Morajeguino. Ese es mi nombre.
¿Qué significa?
Regional. Nombre propio, como si indígena, del clan Gailán. Nosotros somos los clanes Gailán.
Águila, ¿no?
Águila, ¿ves? Pero no es correcto que se siente el Gailán.
Es que no vuela bajito, sino...
Algo alto. Entonces, Pluma y Gaviria que me agradece. Luminoso. Mejor. Eso significa mogaje vivo.
Abuelo, perdón, ¿cuántos años tienes?
73 años, primo.
73 años, son 73 años de experiencia y sabiduría sobre el manejo pleno del medio, de la diversidad.
Yo... Eso llevo. Eso es mi competencia. No, para eso de pronto. Dios me trajo en este mundo para sostener ese sentimiento. Pues sí, obviamente que lo estoy siguiendo. Como les decía hace rato, no he terminado, yo no puedo decir que ya conozco mucho, ya lo miro a todos, no. Todavía me falta. Cuando uno está perdido en la montaña se enamora de él, especialmente uno es borracho. Entonces llega usted a una rama, no es de esta misma, sino de cualquier rama. ¿Sí? Entonces empieza a golpear.
Thank you.
Antiguamente, las indianas nunca tienen pelo en la cara. Así que no se afecta porque ya viene curado de pequeño. La leche de este árbol sirve como pañales. A un niño pequeño preguntaban y se echaba el algodón de hormiga. Y eso sirve como para el mantenimiento de frío. Y la leche también a veces sirve cuando la persona tiene su tortura y que no puede curar, es decir, se curó pero no dio para más, entonces se saca de eso. Y también sirve para aborto. Pues conociendo, sirve para muchos tipos de curación.
Por ejemplo, usted de las medicinas occidentales, ¿qué opina?
Pues esa idea es como costumbre occidental, pues eso es buena, como eso. Como lo mantiene, como lo utiliza, allá como lo ordene, como lo oculta, eso es de ello. No quito razón, ni me acomodo tampoco. Yo me mantengo con los míos.
¿Con sus qué?
Los míos, conocimientos míos, me mantengo, no más.
¿Sí? ¿Se sobre la medicina? ¿Sí?
Muchas veces no, porque hay cosas que no, o sea, a mí no me interesa, ¿no? Ni conocerlos, porque eso es ajeno. Mientras que yo tengo los míos, me defiendo con los míos. Plata domina al mundo. Es una tradición totalmente destructiva, ¿sí? Arruinable. Entonces, ¿qué podemos hacer ahí? Si yo le digo, no hay nada, ¿qué saca el pintor? Le digo, bueno, la vida o la plata. Pero cualquier cosa. Entonces, uno tiene que hablar, bueno, eso pasa en el tiempo. Eso pasó con nuestros abuelos cuando el tiempo era el Perú. Por eso somos huevos de eso. Eso lo vine yo a entender cuando me basé por todo esto. Como el hombre blanco humilla al indígena. Porque eso no tiene plata, no tiene arma. Palabra, consentimiento, no vale para él. No sé de dónde el hombre blanco inventó cerrar paso del agua, terminar, ¿sí? Y meterle cemento en la tierra, y entonces ahí viene el cassette del agua.
¿Qué es dibujar, por ejemplo?
Pues nada. dibujarlo ahí, simplemente sacar una figura ahí, y listo. Porque ya el otro no tiene sentido, no, para dónde voy, para qué, de qué sirve. Solamente una muestra ahí, una figura ahí. Simple. Hasta ahí veo esto.
Así lo vi usted, pero hay otras personas que le dan un valor casi botánico y científico y muy artístico. ¿Usted qué opina de estas personas?
Así como lo aprendieron, así como lo enseñaron, así como lo vivió, pues lo toma a esa medida. Eso como persona, esa cabeza, es un mundo diferente. Así como yo saco figura aquí, como digamos que estamos comparando a ese arco, pues yo lo saqué, esa figura como está usted, como es, para que le está bonito. Y otras personas lo ven y dicen, pues sí, lo sacó así, pero qué es decir, cuál es, mientras que el otro está viendo ya por otro sentido, digamos como lo siente, lo aprendió. Lo cogió y lo conoció, el sentido y importancia de que tiene el valor, el lujo, o no sé, pero otra medida. Mientras que yo lo tengo solamente como por bueno. La figura que yo saco, el dibujo que yo hago, no lo valorizo, sino que lo veo como. Como uno, mientras que otra cosa, ¿sí? Lo que yo valorizo, no lo muestro porque eso está en libre secreto. En cambio, esta persona está valorizando eso materialmente.
Thank you. Welcome everyone. This is Environmental Art and Humanities, Narrating Nature. Ivan, could you please give Don Abel and okay, and welcome back, everyone. This is Narrating Nature. Today and tomorrow we're going to have this workshop in which we're going to try to bridge these worlds that are dividing us, people in the sciences, people in the humanities, just to start conversations, to try to find common ground, put us in the same space for those who work on the spaces, like the space we already saw, the space in which Abel lives, and here. Then this is an exercise of humility to bring us all together, to start conversations, and to try to create the other spaces in which the environment, the arts and the humanities can be together. I have to say thank you to many units here at the University and UNC and elsewhere for their generous participation. The Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies at the University, the Nicholas School of Environment, and the Duke Initiative in Environmental Arts and the Humanities. This event has been sponsored by the Franklin Humanities Institute and was sponsored by the Center for Global Studies and Humanities, the Department of Cultural Anthropology at Duke University and the Anthropology Department at UNC, the Abby Ayala Working Group of the Consortium of Latin American and Caribbean Studies, Duke UNC, and WEGLA, the Working Group in Environmental Environment in Latin America, also part of the consortium. Also the Trillium Project in Sustainability. I have to do also special thanks to Tropenbos International, Tropenbos Como in particular, and for all of the participants coming from many places far beyond and close by. Thank you for being here. My name is Miguel Rojas. I'm the one of the co-conveners of this workshop. Why the politics of plants, as you have seen our little agenda for 3 days, we have four topics that we want to touch on. One is on the politics of plants, then environmental governance, critical zones, laws and bodies, environmental humanities futures, energies, species and culture. These are hopefully the points we're going to touch on today and tomorrow. And today we're starting with on the politics of plants and why the politics of plants, about that, I don't know what we can get a sense of that, but in order to do that, we have Donald to speak about it. I want just to say that this is a twofold thing to start with. And we have the person who is modeling this practice. Twofold. One, plants are the base for paper. And we in academia and sciences, we use paper all the time. We don't even pay attention where it's coming from. Right? This is plant base. Knowledge. This is the way we are taught knowledge. And also, thanks to plants, people in the Amazon basin and many other places of the world, they ponen a rodar la palabra, they start conversations, put the word in motion. In the Amazon basin, in particular, they use something that is called mambe. That is the sacred plant of coca that is toasted with another plant, the jarumo, the leaf of jarumo, that has some alkaline properties. They smash it together and they put it in their mouth. And we have some mambe, do you want to show? This is the second fault, right? Plants require food, plants also help us in another register to archive and transmit knowledge. But this knowledge is embodied knowledge. It's a knowledge that is embedded in us, it's encarnado, it's incorporado. And here we have some, if any of you want to try, this is a way to start the word. It's just coca leaves toasted for everyone. And that's how the transmission of knowledge happens in many of the communities of the Amazon. Then, if anyone is interested, this is the politics of plants. Plants speak through people, and speak to people like Donaway. Then, it's really my real pleasure and honor. I have introduced many people during my many years here at Duke, but today is very, very special for me to introduce not only but all the group that is present in this workshop. But to start with, Olaje with you, or Don Abel Rodriguez, Winane, is here with us. Don Abel is well known in many circles, scientific and cultural, as the plants wise or plants namer, el sabedor o el nombrador o el mortario de las plantas. But according to himself, all his knowledge comes from before, time ago. Not only he inherited from his lineage as Winane Nonuya, one of the 30 that still present today, but comes from the origin itself, from the source, and those are the plants. Don Abel today is a territorialized subject that is part of, or the result of, multiple interruptions on the flows of light and land in the Amazon, particularly the Colombian and Peruvian Amazon. We'll refer a little bit about the long history of water extraction, one of the many levels of destructive enterprises in the Amazon basin. But Don Abel brings us knowledge through other means. His work is just part of a long process of dialogue between knowledges, theirs and ours, that have been developed by his interactions for more than 30 years with scientists, anthropologists, ethnobotanists, biologists, forestry people, etc. This dialogue has established a space of interaction where methodologies of academic and scientific research meet traditional ways of transmission of knowledge. His work allows for an indigenous botanical approach to reveal the great diversity of the species, its attributes, its uses, its location, the architecture behind the forest, the seasonality, the interactions with the human and non-human, and the ecological and symbolical relationships they have among themselves. And nowadays, Don Abel is also not only the last governor of the Nonuyas, but also a well-known and accomplished artist in Western terms, while bringing his embodied practices as woodwind master, because he also is a woodwind master. He weaves fishing traps, nets, gowns, hammocks, all the cultural, the material culture to sustain communities in their own territories. Now he moved into illustration and scientific drawing. He started that practice when he was 60 years old. And Abel is today 75. The video was made 2 years ago. Then he's an artist that started 60. Just take into account. He had not ever drawn before. These drawings are an innovation that Abel appropriated to start a different life against the grain of the expeditionary and scientific purposes, and to show the extent of indigenous knowledge in a Western context. Because in the indigenous world, knowledge is, again, embodied transmitted traditionally to practices and to oral narratives. I'm not going to talk about the work of Mignolo because we have Maria Clara here to speak a little bit on our terms about it, but we have Abel here to speak on his own terms about his work. Then, mi querido Abel, para poner rodar la palabra, work in motion, he has to bring the politics of plants to the town. And now, Lito. Okay. Actually, we're going to do a little break because Donabel is a polyglot. He speaks six languages, five of them from the Amazon to Basin, but unfortunately, English is not one of those. Then, one of the six languages is Spanish. He's been speaking Spanish to us. Then, please, those of you that don't understand Spanish, we have simultaneous translation, Spanish to English, please. We're going to be distributing in the back because we now want to put the word in motion. You get one of the transmitters. We have limited 20 of those. And please raise your hand, and Donna will help us to bring them to you.
Yes. Well, she's not looking at me there.
While people get your computers, thank you so much. When I will speak slowly, then I think that the process of translation is going to be
turned a little bit into lights. Just think if you are in a maloca. In a maloca, the abuelo, the elder, sits and starts talking. In the maloca, we are around him. If you want to get closer, sit close to him on the floor, you are welcome. He will speak for 34 minutes and then we'll start the conversation.
I'm not going to be.
Aquí estoy esperando a ustedes. No porque yo pide venir, sino que me invitaron, no sé por qué, no sé qué vieron en mí o algo. Entonces me invitaron. Entonces yo vine aquí, estoy presente con ustedes. Estoy contento. Espero que me escuche y entienda, porque yo no, el español no es mi idioma para yo expresar lo que debo decir. Ustedes mismos ya saben cómo me llamo yo. Ya escucharon hace rato en el video, de pronto se grabaron, pues eso es mi nombre. Pero voy a repetir. Yo me llamo, mi nombre regional, me llamo Mogaje Gigu. Ese es de los planes de hablar. Nosotros somos del idioma Nunguya, tribu Nunguya. Pero dentro de los libros hay muchas variedades de clanes que hablan el mismo idioma, pero sus clanes son diferentes. Y en castellano todo el mundo ya lo conoce, porque mi nombre ha andado más que yo. A ver. Rodríguez Linares, eso me llamo yo, el nombre castellano, pero yo digo que este nombre es sobrenombre, porque no tiene sentido. Bueno, por eso, así me llamo y soy indígena de centro de Putumayo y capital. Mi pueblo, dentro de la montaña, era La Habana. Ahí me crié, ahí aprendí, me enseñaron, aprendí lo que yo pude aprender, y de eso, pues, esta es la vida mía para el futuro, mientras estoy vivo. Entonces, pues, yo tenía ese conocimiento como idioma propio, con mi lengua, nombres personales, el uso medicinales. Entonces tuve que aprender, porque nosotros, la obligación, tenía que, como joven, tienes que aprender todo lo que es regional para poder ver. Si aprendes bien, pues llega como médico tradicional. Con ese fin, yo me atreví de aprender, pero ya, por ser loco, me desvié y no pude completar mi estudio. Después que me casé, mi profesión era tontería, pesca, agricultura, de eso vivieron por vida sostenida. Yo cuando tuve familia, me pasé a Catetá, viviendo en mi comunidad que se llama Villa Azul. Y ahí formamos dos comunidades como Planes Muñanes y Namuri. Entonces, estando ahí, llegó la investigación occidental que le llama rompe el. Entonces ahí necesitaba que una persona que supiera nombrar los árboles, los usos y los demás, cuando se debía utilizar los árboles. Hubieron muchos, y en eso pues yo era cocinero en ese momento. Entonces, buscaron personas hasta que yo no sé quién lo sabía, que yo entendía, lo sabía, y entonces que era el director del trópico, como colombiano era Juan Santandriada, y él fue que me buscó hasta que me buscaron. Entonces, de ahí pude trabajar con un señor que se llama, un holandés, que se llama yo, y las mujeres que se llama Hans, con ellos que empecé a trabajar, como los colombianos se llamaba, se me fue el nombre. Primero era Mauricio Sánchez. Con él empecé a trabajar como nombrador de las plantas y los árboles y los usos y medicina. Todos esos tipos tuve que darle los nombres como indígena, para comparar el nombre científico. Entonces, estando trabajando en eso, pues ahí quise trabajar por un mes, pero desde ahí me acuerdo ya para siempre. Pues, cuando me encontramos con Esteban Álvarez y Catalina Rondoño, con ellos duré como 2 años, trabajando hasta que ellos terminaron su trabajo, vieron y los otros pues quedaron necesitando más a la gente, personas que debían conocer los nombres, que no cambiaran. Entonces pues así seguí trabajando hasta que se acabó el trabajo de investigación. De ahí salí un trabajo, o de que era sin trabajo, cuando el doctor Carlos ya era como director de Pokémon, en el plato de la Guantanamo. Entonces, trabajamos ya como particular, y ahí que empecé a dibujar, porque ya no tenía. Yo no tenía como para seguir trabajando como un reconocedor. Entonces, pues tuve que empezar a trabajar y dibujar. Ese tipo de dibujo que yo hice, no es porque yo lo aprendí en la escuela, ni en el colegio, ni en ningún lugar, sino solamente de puro vista y de memoria. Sacó de mi cabeza cómo se debe dibujar. De pronto, si hay grabado, pues ahí debo presentar. Mañana le toca. La señora María Clara, ella te mostrará los que, cómo ya había empezado y ella contará más detallado. Así nomás yo por encima cuento los míos. Y de ahí pues se acabó el trompo, entonces tuve que seguir trabajando como yo, y el doctor Carlos los dos particularmente la tabla. Sigo viendo lo que me diga él y lo que yo le hago yo. Entonces,
los que están allí en esos cuadros, esos ya han tratado en estos años, últimamente, de los comienzos de la figura. Parecido a eso mismo, pero más detallado y más, de pronto más bonito, digo yo, especialmente como se ve como en las selvas propias, selvas nativas. Por lo tanto, aquí pues, lo tengo desafiado. Solamente los árboles grandes nomás y los pequeños no están. Eso era, de esta manera yo me metí en este tipo de trabajos. Y eso me hizo andar por todos lados, casi por todos lados, se puede decir que no sé, que la suerte mía, o quizás que sea la ayuda del creador. Esto es mi asunto de la vida. Ya.
Part of what they do is in the circles is to tell the stories of origin. Right now, he just told us very briefly his story of encounter with the white people and why he was chosen to do what he does. Now he's going to share a short story. These stories can take hours, nights, and sometimes days to be told. He's going to, he just prepared in very short time that central drawing to bring it to tell this story. This is a very short story that he's going to share with us.
Ahí, lo que yo titulé es solamente como nuevo. Los dos árboles tienen, cada árbol tiene sus cuentos, digamos, sus historias. ¿Sí? Aquí, en este lado, está el sol y la luna. Donde empezó, digamos, que el tipo de castigo para el hombre indígena. Y el otro lado está figurando como tipo parte de guerra. O sea, nace brujerías, donde haces cantidades, todas maldades. Eso refiere a este lado de águila. Dice que nosotros somos clanes de ese águila. Este es el nido. Y el nido de mochilero. Y el árbol se llama. Pues lo llamamos como árbol de mochilero. Este lado de este árbol se llama, nosotros en el idioma decimos Ame. El amarillo se llama Ecumbo. Así lo llamamos en el idioma. Entonces, cada parte tiene su historia, ¿verdad? Parte de Gavilán es una historia aparte, y de aquel de Soy la Luna es otra historia. Entonces, representa dos tipos de historias aquí. Si en mis años se pueden contar los dos, si no, pues, ¿cómo me pasa? Si lo están viendo ahí,
Este es el sol y ese es la luna. Y este es el pájaro guacamaya. Fue hecho por él. El sol lo hizo como pájaro, como un animal, para engañando al hermano para hacer un castigo. A ver, porque el conflicto de esos para nosotros es parte de educación, donde se previene y se prohíbe. Para nosotros, donde nace el respeto. Y si no hay ese acuerdo, si nadie sabe eso, ¿por qué se prohíbe de ser más de picardía a los hermanos? Hay que tener respeto, porque es un delito para el hombre y para la mujer, lo mismo. Entonces, dicen las narraciones que el hermano es un hermano que se debe amar y se debe respetar y se debe ayudar de otra forma. Y cuando tengas una mujer, pues hay que respetar, porque dice que es mujer, el hermano tiene respeto como cualquier hermana, como madre, como... ¿sí? Así se trata. Si no hay ese acuerdo, pues llega en ese conflicto. Entonces, pues, estos dos sol y la luna vivían, los dos. No es el mundo que vivimos, estamos viviendo, sino es ese mundo, era principio según generación. Y por eso, pues eran dos, vivían los dos hermanos y la mamá. La mamá le conservaba todo, como estoy diciendo en una parte. Entonces, como cuñado, él respetaba a la cuñada. Pero cuando el tentador se metió en ella, él estaba pintando ahí, atrás de la maloca, con pintura que nosotros siempre usamos, de día de baile, de día de inclinación. Es una intención para la pintura. Esa pintura protege mucho. El que sabe curar, poner pintura, dice que no envejece nunca. Puede ser viejo, tiene figura como. Y luego el muchacho estaba sacando fibra para tejer balay, para mamar, para el material de trabajo. Y en eso, pues, él estaba sentando, sacando fibra cuando ella acabó de pintar ese vino y le dijo: señor, ¿qué hace? No, le estoy sacando fibra para hacer el balay, para el lado. En eso, pues, le dio, pues, ¿qué será? El pintor. Y le dio tan bonito que el joven usted no le pinta como yo. Le pasó la mano en la cara. Y una vez quedó el pintado, porque la pintura no respeta, no perdona. Y le dio manchado la cara, se agachó. Ahora sí, tengo problemas con mi hermano. Y fue así, como ya sabía de que la mamá, aconsejándose, educado, le contaba de que por qué no se debe hacer así. Entonces, llegó la noche, se fue para la quebrada, lavarle la cara, siempre la cara que quedó pintado, manchado. Entonces, pues, él llamó hasta los tribus de él,
para que le quitara esa mancha. Por más que ellos la vieron chuparon, pero que siempre quedó la cara manchada. A medianoche llegó a la maloca y nos acercó al hermano. Y entonces, Dios le dijo, hermano, ya está listo la coca, venga a mamber. ¿Por qué pasó? Porque no abrimos temprano. Entonces, para ir sacando, pues, tanto día que estaba, se sentía muy malo, muy cansado, entonces, pues, no se acercó al mamber. Cuando llegó, pues, venga el mamber y después se acuesta a descansar. Entonces se fue, apenas no se mostró de frente, sino se fue de medio lado y se sentó de medio lado. Primero pues le cayeron la malicia a mi hermano y dijo, ¿de qué pasó? Porque mi hermano está apenado y no me quiere mostrar la cara. Cuando le ofreció en Mambes, el señor de medio lado también. En eso es pues, el hermano quedó mirando y dijo, pues, siempre se veía la mancha de la pintura. Entonces él dijo, hermano, pues, tiene razón que tiene, me tiene pena porque él estaba con mi mujer. Pues, eso es todo, no hay más duda. Entonces, así quedó resentido contra el hermano y le dijo, de frente no puedo matarlo porque mi mamá no me rebaja ni me perdona. ¿Yo qué hago con este hombre? Porque si empezaron así, pues seguiría la tía, entonces pues, no lo puedo perdonar. Él buscó la manera como acabar con la vida de mi hermano. Entonces él inventó esa forma. Y esto le sacó dos pepas de piña recién, Fernando, antes de echarlo como la pepa, pues, el pechito es colorado, entonces sacó eso y dos piñas de otra vez y creó ese arco y con los huecos de las en el árbol, entonces ahí él colocó esas dos piñas rojas y lo disfrazó como guacamaya. Ya después que hizo eso, llegó a la casa todo contento. Aquí lo va a coger. Entonces, aquí dentro de este hueco lo va a cerrar, allá tiene que morir, allá tiene que morir. Diciendo esto, inventó, creó otro árbol donde iba subiendo él. Ahí le dijo, mire hermano, a pie de la charla hay un árbol grande, en ese árbol hay una cría de guacamayos. Los papás se cruzan por ahí, bueno, trayendo comida, si lo han visto ustedes. Entonces, pues él dijo para, aunque no me diga, pero él dijo que sí, yo lo vi, por ahí anda. Entonces, pues mañana, si no tienen trabajo, pues vamos a hacer eso. El trabajo fue sacar esas dos crías para tener el frío en la casa. Son bonitos, son simpáticos y tienen una pluma para tener de adorno, hacer corona para nosotros, pluma para nosotros. Vengo para el tierra, lo engañó. Y el otro, pues el hermano, pues todo inocente creyó y lo aceptó. Entonces, ese fue el día que se fueron así como estaban. Hay otro árbol a la vez, un poquito más, más bajito que el hueco, pero entonces se puede jalar y amarrar con un bejuco, ahí se puede hacer puente para poder bajar esos dos pájaros. Entonces, así llegaron allá, fueron a sacar bejuco, cortaron balas, hacer un puente. Entonces, él le dijo, suba usted como joven, como yo soy mayor, yo no tengo ese equilibrio para poder estar subiendo. Estoy levantando las barras de los peujos. Entonces, así, me mandó el hermano y te doy el panaba allí. Ese es el sol. Y es el luna que está subiendo para hacer el puente para bajar el pájaro. Y están las paras y los bejucos. Entonces, antes de hacer el puente, se estaba subiendo al canto de allí, cuando subió más alto con el bejuco jalando el árbol, casi que llegaba. Entonces quedó cerca del hueco donde estaban los dos crías. Entonces él hizo un puente, pasó para coger el pajarito y el pajarito cuando vio a él se metió más para adentro. Y en eso pues él se metió más cerca y hasta que ya por hecho del hermano mismo hace una maldad que por lo que no avanza el puente se reventó y el árbol se abrió y se quedó acá atajado. Entonces el hermano dijo pues tranquilo que yo estoy aquí abajo, ahorita yo le ayudo a amarrar otra vez para que baje, mientras sea allá y coja. Entonces él se metió, pero yo no quiero entrar y se metió para adentro cuando una llamada desde el candela se le prendió y quedó hasta jamás yo. Y ahí lo cerró, el cuerpo se estampó y no pudo salir. Eso es, esa figura que dice de esa manera. Gracias.
The Sun and the Moon, one of the original stories of the Amazon jungle. If you got some of the meaning, the brother moon, his face is damaged by the paint in the moment of interacting with the sun's wife. The moon has manchas, right?
Spots.
That's one. The other one is the brother doesn't want to show his face. Right? He just shows part of his face, the faces of the moon. And why the moon is hanging in there, right? Is because the sun creates this tree for the moon to be there on the sky. And the issue of a fruit that becomes a bird that is part of the ritual, the rituals, the feathers that are used, guacamayas and rojas, and they're red, very important. I mean, it's all sorts of connections that are part of this, the stories of origin. Now, let me introduce you. Maritana Vanderhaven. Maritana is a cultural anthropologist with a PhD from the University of Utrecht in the Netherlands. She is a very well-known anthropologist with many, many groups working on issues of governance of indigenous peoples in the Amazon and in other regions of Colombia. Recently has been completely embedded in the discussions about keeping safe los páramos, the high lands in which the waters are flowing in Colombia and in the Andes. She's the editor of Revista Antropología y Arqueología. She's a professor of Universidad Externada de Colombia. She also works with Tropicals International of Colombia. She has known well for many, many, many years. And she will tell us a little bit about the story. Please, Marisol.
Thank you. That's so many books.
No, so many books.
I will do the same as Abel. I will try to talk in English because it's not that well. I mean, you can understand me. Abel's Spanish is better than my English. Well, first, we want to thank the leaders of this workshop for inviting us here. And for us, as Tropicals Colombia, I've been involved in this organization. It's a non-governmental organization for many years now, almost 30 years. It has presence in Colombia. It was a Dutch origin, the NGO. And as Abel told us, this NGO started doing a lot of natural science research in the Amazon. The first task was to try to understand from a natural sciences point of view how this tropical humid forest was working. Well, a lot of people started to work almost 30 years ago in the forest, trying to understand the water cycles, the nutrient cycles, the diversity of species, this diversity of landscapes, trying to understand plant-animal relationships, trying to understand what was happening and how this amazing, diverse ecosystem was keeping going on in this place. And they started to work in one of the places, the community where Abel lives, used to live in Peñaroma. They had a small research center, just small house, all the indigenous houses where all these researchers were living. And there was where Abel started to work just as a guide, not really recognized as an author, as a knower, but just as a guide. He was helpful to identify differences between plants, helpful to know where they can find them, where if there were other places, the distribution of the different plants. And he worked that way like 2 decades. Well, in the meantime, there were also some social scientists working in the area a bit in a different way. And especially when I was in me, my husband, the director of this NGO at the moment, started to work in the region. We wanted, after having done in the same region our PhD research, we wanted to collaborate with the people trying to develop some management plans together with the governmental institutions. And we started to work with the communities trying to find a language to communicate to the government their way of management. And in this context, we started to talk with the elders of most of these communities along the Capital River in the Amazon region, 100 kilometers distance. We worked with different communities. And most of the elder people were very worried, concerned about their knowledge. And the less that there were so less young people interested in learning this knowledge. It's hard to learn this knowledge in most of this area. In this area, people have to learn, sit down evenings, listening to these stories, not such a short version as now, but very long versions. You have to to sit and take this mambe and have a lot of tobacco and then lots of nights you have to sit down and try to learn everything by heart. And all this knowledge was also accompanied by a lot of restrictions. Your diet, you cannot eat everything, so you have to have very strict diets in order to learn. It seems to be a connection between diet and your capacity to memorize. We were talking with Fernando about it. And there is also a lot of sexual restrictions, so you can't have intercourse with anybody if you are in the train of learning this. So they were very worried, and we started a program, like a strategy, to try to offer just as wide academic researchers were having a grant from this NGO to do their research. We started to give some grants also to elder people in order to find ways, explore new ways of communicating and transmitting their knowledge. They said, well, now today the people want new ways to learn. They don't want to sit down. In this way, we have to try new ways. And this way, we formed a lot of small groups, people of different generations working together, trying to write down their knowledge, etc. Also, people writing down, some started to write, others started to paint, others started to, and nowadays we have people making pictures, videos, and even people making animations with videos in order to transmit this information. And not only in their own context, in the community level, but also a way to communicate in a better way to scientific context. Because the experience was that they were used as guides, but not as knowledgeers, really knowledge holders, and that being persons with knowledge of their own. So we started this program, and then Abel came to Bogota for various reasons. He had to leave his territory, and he came to Bogota in 2003. He went to the office, and he needed money, of course. And he said, well, I want to work with you. I've been working a long time with all these biologists, ecologists. And, so do you have some work for me? And, well, we told him about the grants, about the possibility to work on his own knowledge, trying to record it, to work it out in a way he wanted to work it out. He didn't want to write. He has only a few years of primary school. He's not able to write very easily. It's not. Whereas some of these pictures have some text, and it was very hard for him to write, especially in Spanish or in his own language. His language has no alphabet. There are no Spanish speakers anymore of this language. Language, so he also always speaks in Unani. It's the language he dominates best, his mother's language. And so we asked him if he didn't want to try out with his son to record his knowledge. And then he said, no, I need the forest to teach my son. I can't teach him only by head. He has to go into the forest, he has to see the plants, he has to know them, he has to smell them, he has to touch them. And then we asked him and we pushed him a bit to try out in the way if he was able to paint. And he was a bit reluctant, he didn't want to paint. But I think because he really needed the money of this grant, he tried it out. And. It was really amazing. We were working at this moment on weaving techniques and all the plants they use to weave their baskets and these fish traps. And he started to paint. The first thing that he painted was a basket. And he painted it as if the strokes were the lianas. And he did it in a way you weave the baskets. So finally, at the end, he had a wonderful basket, and you could see the perspective of this basket. It was really amazing that he translated his knowledge, graphic knowledge, in three dimensions into two dimensions. And afterwards, he started to paint this liana they used to make this part and for making this basket. And this was really, really something we had not seen before of any of the indigenous people who were in trying to paint their knowledge, trying to figure it, show this knowledge in another way. We really showed us Ariane. It was really a living being. It was as if you could see that this liana was cramped. It was holding strong to this tree, and you could see it really as something that was really alive. And I think it's something what some anthropologists call perspectivism, that you can see the world from the perspective of different species. You can see the world as if you are a jaguar. You can see the world as if you are a fish. You can see the world as if you were a plant. And this was really amazing to see. It was not painting in a spontaneous way. He was really trying to paint it in this way. But it was wonderful what came out. So we really pushed him to go on and to try out this way of communicating. And I wanted to show you some of these pictures and trying to show you how this work evolved, because it has been now more than 10 years that he has received this grant. It has been a patient, long relationship. There is no hurry. He's trying to find out ways to communicate. We help him with this small grant so that he can learn something. And well, nowadays the thing is quite different. He's selling quite well his paintings, so he doesn't need to grant anymore. But for long years, it has been a very slow, long work. This has been very important to him. In order to give these grants, we talk very long with people so that the objectives of the grant are clear, that they really make a good proposal of what they want to reach with what they are going to do, who they want to reach, what kind of language or what kind of methods they want to develop in this work. One of these first things we asked him after that we worked on these lianas and the different baskets and all this work was to paint all the different trees he knew by heart. He had been working with all these biologists, ecologists. They had made these permanent plots in the field, and we knew he knew more than 400 species, different species. So we asked him if he could try to paint these different species. So one of the first things he did was to paint all these different species, and they were really amazing. Maybe they look simple, but they have all the characteristics he needs to recognize them. So he's not making a photographic, realistic image of the tree. He is trying to communicate with these pictures. Really the essence for him, the real characteristics of the trees. So if it's important to distinguish because it has a special bark, emphasis the bark. If it are the way the leaves are organized, then he will make emphasis. If it is the color, if it's the way it grows, it's the trees that grow just straight. Some are always growing a bit inclined. And all these characteristics, he also wrote them down. So we started to see this whole classification system. The first classification system that he used, but he also used another. We started to talk with him, and then he said, there are other things you can't paint. Well, there are a lot of things you can't paint. You can't paint the spirit of the plant. There are a lot of things that are not visible of a plant that you cannot paint. But he also told us that to know a plant, you know, have to know him in all his different phases. So you have to know the plant from seed, as it germinates, as it, as you have to just small tree and then and until it's a big tree, and you have to notice different forms because they are quite different when they are young and when they are old. And these characteristics are very important not only to recognize, not only because I want to recognize these plants, but because these characteristics are used in shamanistic healing processes. So the kind of force, the kind of plant, the kind of distribution, these characteristics that are so important are used to evoke these characteristics in ill people in order to make them better, to organize the energies of the world. Another thing that he started to work on, next phase, another grant, and next year, he started to work this very complex relationship between plants and animals. He knew a lot about this, and it was also very important. It's also very important when you want to use these plants in a medicine context. It's very important to know if a plant is eaten by a certain species, the kind of energy it can transmit. So he worked out all these characteristics. And then, he said, the tree, you can't understand the tree only by itself. You have to understand the tree as part of the context, as a part of being part of the forest. So he started to paint different forest types, showing these trees being part of different forest types, which are really very amazing pictures because they are like they're floating in the air in some way, but they have all the species and all the elements that make for him his way of differentiating different landscapes, different forest types. And then, he started to talk to us about how important it was to understand the forest also during the annual cycle. That these different forest types are changing all the year around. So it's not the same in the summertime as in wet time and rainy season or in dry season. And all these different seasons, and he started to paint the same forest. Different moments along the year, and you have to look quite detailed, and then you can see what is going on, how the phenology of these plants is changing, how they are fruiting, giving flowers, how they are changing along the year. So all these rhythms are very important. Then in another occasion, we were working about the gardens, the chakras of the indigenous people in there. And he made a lot of pictures and beautiful work about all his knowledge about cultivated plants. He knew a lot of it. And what is so interesting about his pictures, because we never tell him, you have to paint this way or you have to paint the other way. He is the one who defines how he wants to paint. A lot of people have offered to give him lessons. We always say, no, please. He doesn't need any lessons. He has his own knowledge and he knows how to express it. So you can see that he always painted the chakra in the context of the forest. Because this chakra, you can only understand this plots as being part of the forest. It's just momentary that these cultivated plants are there, and then starts the forest starts to grow up again in these places, and then finally it will be forest again. And he always expresses this as being part of the forest, not as something that you can notice these different forest types that you can see by as standing for themselves. But this has always to be understood together with the forest. He also painted all these different cultivars. There are lots more. There are the different cultivars that he that they have in their plots, in their chakras. Each ethnic group has its own set of plants. So he painted especially the Nomoya, the Moinane varieties. the use of chontaluro, of the cassava, of the nyame, of the pineapple, of all these different species with their own varieties. And this is a set of paintings he made specially thinking of an educational program in which for him it was very important that even in the surroundings of the house, young children can learn by observing what is changing in the surroundings of the, these malocas of round houses. So he made a lot of pictures of all the varieties and different plants and how everything changes around the maloca and all the difference you can see just by sitting at home. You don't have to eat, to go into the forest. You can start to learn, and that's the way children start to learn of their environment. Well, one of the last phases of his work is he started to paint and bit on his own initiative. He started to paint just as the one we saw, and he explained the story about the sun and the moon. This is also a very important tree. It's not a tree you can see. It's the tree of abundance. It's the idea of the abundance, the idea of how life functions in the forest, how the different energies are flowing in the forest and how they came into being, and how the forest and this tree of abundance gives food and energy to all animals and also to all people. So, and this is the, well, this is one of his paintings. It's in the National Museum of Bogota. They have it now there. One of his most beautiful pieces. And he's now starting to do this kind of work of trying to transmit also this not visible stories which talk about this, this knowledge of the forest. It's what I wanted to share with you. Yeah.
Humanities opening of environmental arts and humanities workshop. We hope to see you tomorrow. All of you, it's getting better and better and better. And now, to keep on the conversation, we'll invite Professor Marisol de la Cadena and Professor Walter Mignolo to share some thoughts on the spot on this. I don't think so. I don't think they need any introduction so far. Marisol de la Cadena is not only a member of our community, she is a professor at UNC and interacted with many of you around many years. She has not ever left us. Thank you to Professor. She comes all the time, and she's the reference of many of the new generations of anthropologists from the West Coast and the East Coast, but it's important to bring this out. She's from Lima, Peru, and from Bass, and the most wonderful book, Her Beings, was just published by Duke University Press three or four months ago. Go and get it, because it's definitely a book on how to do differently, a different anthropology, a different anthropology. It's very much connected to what this is doing. And Professor Walter Mignolo, member of the house, sensei, we call him Tata or Tanta, one of the elders for many. Please come and join us and share your thoughts about Manuel and about his coming from the
conversation.
And a conversation, of course, and also we want to talk about it. So, we have a
Pasamos en castellano.
But then let me, yes, because there are, hay gente que no habla español.
Tenemos Iván.
You try it too.
But
you have to continue translating for Don Abel, so.
O le traduces a Don Abel, más bien. Yeah, that'll be better.
Okay, so, I think,
whether we ask,
yeah, there are.
Cannot follow Spanish. How many people cannot understand Spanish? Three or four?
Yeah, I think do it in English, yeah.
Okay, so, I had many, many thoughts as I was listening and looking at what was going on. And at first I thought that I was going to talk only about Abel, but then I think it's more than talking about Abel that I am going to do here, because I think that what this workshop is about is, to begin with, it is a workshop. And it is a workshop in which translation has been enacted all the time, even this very minute. What language do I talk in? Do I speak in English, in Spanish, and why would I speak in one of the two? And so I wanted to call attention to the role that translation is playing in the workshop. And I want us to really think about this event as something that we are enacting and something in which translation is a huge thing. And then there's another thing that's going on that is also divergence. And I'm going to explain what I mean by divergence in a second, but I say these two things, translation and divergence, to point out at something that we have enacted here together. Not only in the relationship between Maria Clara and Abel, and who is that your name?
Carlos.
And Carlos and Miguel, and the idea of, and Miguel's idea, when I asked, one of the things that I shared with Don Abel is that I didn't know why I was here either. I was told by Arturo that I had to come. And I obey Arturo. Or else he won't be thirsty. And I came. So Abel and I shared not knowing why we're here. And that also, and I'm saying that not only to be funny, but to say two things. First, what I wanted to say is that what we're enacting here is more than one world. Okay, we're enacting an encounter of several worlds. In several worlds, I do not only mean indigenous and non-indigenous, North American and South American, but I also mean the world of the humanities and the world of the sciences. So many worlds are being enacted here, and the tool for that enactment is translation, and the relation that is transpiring is divergence. And by divergence, what I mean is we all have an interest in common, or else we would not be here. But that interest in common is not the same interest. So divergence is that moment in which we get together and then we separate. And we create a common interest from the uncommonalities that have brought us together to that common interest. Okay, so translation and divergence in the enactment through translation of multiple worlds. And I repeat, not only indigenous and non-indigenous, but also science, the humanities, north and south. And I think that in the relationship between Maria Clara and the institute that Carlos and Abel have, what you have there is a relationship of divergence and interest in common that's not the same interest, but it's an interest in common. And I think that the fruitfulness of the relationship is that the interest in common has not become the same interest. And I think that maintaining the difference, interest in common that's not the same interest, in attempting to articulate that commonality in divergence, in symmetry, and against the structural hierarchy that articulates your difference is the success of the relationship. And I think it's a beautiful relationship, but it's also a relationship that's replete with excess. So when Maria Clara was going to translate Abel, Abel said, she is going to tell you in more detail what I have said. That more detail is the excess that Maria Clara can get to us that Abel cannot. But then there's a lot of things that Maria Clara could not tell us that Abel was telling us and that we might not get. So it's relation, translation, enactment of multiple worlds through or with excess. And I think I do want to emphasize excess because I think that the success of that relationship is that it has allowed excess to be, that there's no attempt at pretending that you know what Abel knows. And Abel obviously does not pretend to know what Maria Clara and Carlos know. When he says about Occidental, about biomedicine, that's not my thing. I'll use it, but it's not my thing. I don't attempt to know. So, and there's excess to his knowledge that biomedicine presents to him, and he lets the excess be. I think the success in a very unique thing about that relationship is that I think that you've also let excess be. And the idea that you're not understanding one-to-one what he's trying to do. So I think that's the way it should be, like you understand what you understand, that you allow for equivocation to be, and that equivocation, of course, is not misunderstanding. It is a way of translation. It's a theory of translation. I'm totally borrowing from the same author that you borrowed, Perspectivism, Eduardo Viveiros de Castro. And one of the lines that Eduardo has that I really like is that the opposite of equivocation is the univocal. The problem that undoes equivocation is not to re-understand, but to make of that understanding one. And that instead, equivocation as a relation of translation that allows for the multivocal, for the more than one understanding that's also connected, is a successful relation through translation that allows for divergence. Okay, I think that's what I have to say. Okay.
Wow. The soup is getting very thick. But I think this is a connect. I think that to connect is what Abel is confronting us with is breaking the totality of knowledge. We live in a kind of fiction of a totality of knowledge that have all the kind of Western vocabulary. So if we continue to say in a written nature, the totality of knowledge wins.
It will continue to work. Huh?
The nature wins, right? Because nature is a Western invention, we know, right? The distinguished culture. And then, when the new world was discovered, guess what? We identified the Americas with nature, right? But nature from the perspective of European. So now we have Abel who said, I don't care about that biomedicine is not my thing, Linnaeus is not my thing, and all the scientific classification of plants. You can classify the plants all you want, but
I don't care about nature. I care about life. I care about plants. I care about the kind of the cycle with the kind of life. So I think that the problem is not nature that is in danger, it's life that is in danger. So that's one of the things that just I'm gonna put on the table, what you call divergence. He is breaking up the totality of knowledge. He said, we don't get it all. There are other knowledges that we don't know. I mean, I've been looking at Ronald Longford here. So that is the kind of, I don't want to be too long, but I want to tell a story too, because I think that is a question. When the totality of knowledge is breaking, so we tell stories. So I tell you three or four short stories. About 3 years ago, about this time of the year, I received a letter from the Clouds Foundation, confidential letter. We're going to give a special award to Robert Rodriguez, and I invite you to write this 1,000 text for this. 2 months later, I had to go to Bogota, and I said, well, that's my opportunity. So, because I have until October, November to write 1,000 words, so well, I would get a lot of information, and I would do it. You know. So, I was invited by the Lozano University, the kind of design, the School of Design. We have lunch, and I just said, hey, tell me what you know about Abel Rodriguez. Well, nobody knew anything. We chatted a little bit, and then I went to the hotel and said, well, these people are from the School of Design. What do they know about plants and animals and all that? And next day, I have a meeting with philosophers. I said, well, now, this is mine. So I asked the philosopher, Abel Rodriguez. So nobody knew about Abel Rodriguez. So I'm really glad that Abel Rodriguez is here, may not be known in that school of Tadeo Lozano, but I think that we are honored in giving him an honor to kind of letting him to tell us his story. Another part of the story I want to tell is when I went to university, I went to study philosophy. So guess what? The first course I took was Greek philosophy. So we bought a big book that was for the entire year called Paideia, of a German guy called Werner Jaeger or something like that. So I learned that Paideia is education. And reading the book, I learned that education was enkyklos Paideia, learning in circle. But then came the British and wrote the Encyclopedia Britannica and wrote that, make us forget about Enkyklos Paideia. And now we realize that the Greek have more in common with many kind of communities of the world that still learn in circle, that kind of learning in books. So is that Enkyklos Paideia that brought the concept of nature? And I think that we have to be very serious here to question the question of nature, because nature was a classification that simplified the diversity of living and make it more easy to control it, right? At the same time, we can say that the totality of Western knowledge invented the concept of women. So that was very useful for them to come to the new world and say, well, there are women, and let's leave the religious aside and the witch hunt and also. But then when I connect with that, there were no women. There were just the feminine and the masculine. So the sun and the moon were the kind of expression, the manifestation of the feminine and the masculine, because the energy that created the world was androgynous, was both feminine and masculine, and feminine masculinities all through the living. But the concept of woman allows to say, well, certain bodies are women, certain bodies are men, and that's everything that kind of get out of that classification transgress the rule of the ethical rule of the Christian cosmology. So when we hear Abel Rodriguez telling the story of the plant and the fluidity of the plant, I mean the names of the plant, there is no nature there. They're kind of living organisms, and living organisms that transform themselves apart of the meat and out of the whatever you wanna call it. So that break on the totality of knowledge makes me ask, and we can start the conversation here, what do we do with the knowledge that we have, transmitted by Abel, but also transmitted by Maria Clara? What do we do with that knowledge? Now that we know, especially this time, the last 3 or 4 years, everybody's saying the Indians have different concepts of nature, they kind of connect everything. Yeah, we know that. And we can know more and more, and I think that tonight we have learned more. We have learned more, not just the knowledge, but how somebody who lives in that world live that knowledge, right? So how the kind of the life and knowledge are connected, because as Arturo knows, our friend Maturana would say, knowing is living, and living is knowing, because if you don't know, you don't live, right? So the question I open for conversation is, now that we know that, we know the divergence, we know that the totality of knowledge being breaked up, so what do we know? Now Duke is talking about sending faculty to organize workshop beyond knowledge. Hey, good afternoon. I've been doing that for 30 years. Now you discover that we have to go beyond knowledge, and you send a few faculty to train other faculty to go beyond knowledge. I think that this is the question that that Abel Rodriguez kind of opened for us. One thing is to do it among ourselves, and the other is to have a bed here telling the story. That is a kind of the force that move that possibility of changing the term of the conversation.
Okay. You can break 2 minutes, straight legs, get a wine, and start the conversation. And right now, start the conversation. It's up to you. 3 minutes, we have 30 minutes at least, talk. We have to leave around 8. And 2 minutes, stretch your legs.
I'm not sure. Interacting. What we have here,
And remember, we have an auditor there, waiting for questions and comments, and what do you think about what you've seen, and the locations that you might saw in the water. Share with us this conversation about worlds, vertical and horizontal disciplines, practices, and knowledge that is in and out. Archives, all of those things that I'm talking about, the politics of plants, per se. Two, then anyone.
Gracias. Es una pregunta para Don Abel. This is a question for Don Abel. And I guess maybe I'll do it in Spanish and English. I'm getting mixed messages, but that's a difficult point. Pues hemos hablado muchísimo de lo visual. We've spoken a lot about the visual. Pero la pregunta que tengo yo es sobre el oír y el oír con las plantas, el sonido, porque me pareció cuando usted habló que lo que yo estaba pensando era estamos experimentando algo en el sonido, en el oír, en el escuchar. So I just wanted to ask a little bit about sound. Because as he was speaking and telling us things, I was experiencing a lot about sound. And I feel like sound has a lot to do, I don't know. That's the question.
Para nosotros, uno se da cuenta o sentimos los sonidos de los árboles o clase, digamos que sonido grillo, que no lo vemos, el sonido del viento, el cambio de tiempos. Lo sentimos concentrado, sentado ahí en el círculo, hablando, pensando. En ese momento nos damos cuenta cuando cambia el tiempo, cuando llegan los malos tiempos, cuando llega el buen tiempo. Tipo de, como decir, para decir, los marinos cuando pasan, cuando llega el momento de la concentración propia de espíritus propios que protege a nosotros en qué momento y cuándo se va.
This sound is important because when we are in the circle of knowledge, we are aware of the sounds of the forest, the crickets, birds, the wind, the touch of the leaves, and that comes to us and tell us when things are going to change or when things are going to happen. Then yes, we are aware of
Are you guys ready for
eso es, para eso hay para nosotros la enseñanza, no solamente para conocer los nombres de la planta y la medicina, sino también el contenido de los espíritus. No solamente espíritu marino ni espíritu santo, sino que también los árboles y los animales tienen sus espíritus, sus poderes,
este momento ataca. Entonces, para conocer eso, está el estudio.
Questions?
Bueno, hablo en español también, oportunidad. Mira, don Abel, me gustaría de entender la perspectiva que tienen en la comunidad, la relación de las personas de la comunidad con la producción de los alimentos para la continuidad de la existencia en la forma como se organizan ahí para la relación con el sol, con los frutos, con los animales, con las plantas. Y te voy a llevar acá para Cristina el sistema energético. Gracias.
Es, digamos que para nosotros, así como se empieza el diálogo en Mampiaderas, se nombra toda clase de tipos, empezando muchas veces de la persona, de persona a la charla, de la charla a la selva, de la selva otra vez a la casa. ¿Cuál es el alimento que prácticamente nos conviene, nos pertenece, que el mismo creador, cuando después que creó el mundo, dejó ordenados frutas comestibles, y no solamente de comer, sino que de comer está la vida, y los mismos frutos son medicina? Entonces se practica eso en esa manera, y el seguimiento sigue regresando, hablando, continuando los órdenes de cumplir con la verdad.
Gisela. A ver, yo quería
preguntarle a qué materiales usted utiliza cuando hace las pinturas, si son materiales orgánicos, si puede explicarnos cómo es el proceso, cuánto tiempo usted establece o del momento que usted empieza hasta que el momento que usted termina, cómo es el proceso de cada dibujo, cada pintura.
Bueno, como parte de una pintura, estas pinturas que yo uso no son tradicionales, son occidentales. Entonces, ahí no te puedo explicar, porque no soy, es decir, que para mí es ajeno. La pintura que yo comentaba cuando son y la luna que se colocaron ahí, es decir, por eso, pues, una parte toqué diciendo que esa pintura que significaba que acabo de llevar.
He uses tinta china, yeah. You can, in his translation.
Don Abel, al principio, empezó a trabajar con el espejo, con micropunta. Y hacía, como te recomendaba, con gran dificultad. Porque el micropunta no se permite fluidez. Después ya iba cambiando, pasó por colores, pues mejor en colores. Y fue explorando. Se metió con acuarela, pero no hablaba. Se metió con óleo, no dejaba demasiado. Hasta que llegó a la tinta china. Y era por en su búsqueda de ver los tonos de verde. Y un día dijo: vamos a buscar los tonos de verdes en los colores, y copió todos los azules. La diferencia entre verdes y azules es verdad, que no se nota mucho en el mundo indígena. Y la tinta, porque él ensayan chamas, esas telas de las corteras de los árboles se dibujan con tintes naturales. Y pasar de tinta a tinta era el que le permitía las transparencias y el movimiento. Y aquí tengo que contar una anécdota muy, muy linda. Nosotros trabajamos apoyando unas tesis de doctorado en arquitectura en los árboles. Y pues ahí se estudia el árbol con todo su detalle. Pues don Abel, como lo acompaña, lo tenía metido en su cabeza. Entonces sabía exactamente la reiteración de la estructura, las repeticiones y la distribución de las hojas, de los foliones. Y el uno decía, pero no me va bien este árbol, no me va bien porque todo el tiempo se está moviendo, los hojas son finitas y el viento, la pregunta del viento y los sonidos, la mueve. Y el doctor PhD en arquitectura de árboles, cuando vio ese, dice, es increíble lo que logra con la tinta china, porque esas hojas en la naturaleza siempre se están moviendo. Eso solo lo logra don Abel a partir de su conocimiento del árbol.
Quiero una cosita, hermano, una cosita. En este momento, this is a moment, this is a kind of call to labor that I want to call attention to. So Abel answered, and then Carlos continued the answer. So it's not only Abel, it's the collaboration between both of them in making that. So, and the first sentence in Abel's response was, no sé, porque no, esos son métodos que no conozco, or something like that. And then that's when Carlos comes in and explains in a beautiful non-dismissal of each other, but in merging with, while at the same time leaving that which the other doesn't understand out there, not necessarily visible, but to our senses. I mean, it can be sensed. And I think that that's what I really find extraordinary about what we are experiencing here. It's not only talking to a baby, but talking to the call labor.
Thank you.
Just want to tell one detail of how knowledge is lived in this area, from my point of view, of course, which has been always very amazing to me and very difficult to understand. I don't know if I understand it really. All these people, they are very different kind of people living together in this area. So it's very multicultural area. Different languages, different people, different together there. And these different groups are also divided by different clans. And all these clans have their own knowledge. So there is a kind of Pan-Amazonic knowledge. So all the Amazonian Indians tell stories about the sun and the moon and the incest. Stories about are related the ancestors with this kind of stories, but they have all their own version. They have all their own knowledge. When Abel says he's asked about the biomedicine and what he feels about it, oh, that's for them. It's that's their world. The same happens with his neighbors. So he's living together with local indigenous people, he's living together with Yukuna Indians, with Bora Indians, and they always will say, well, that's the way they see it. We see it in another way. So every group has its own knowledge, and if you don't have this knowledge, you're nothing, you're nobody. You have to have your own knowledge to be something in this world. So you have to have knowledge given by the region. You have to know all these original stories so you can be something, somebody in this web of knowledge groups that are all together making the world function. And not only these different groups, but then the people in the group itself has their own knowledge. So Abel doesn't know exactly the same as his brother knows or his other brother knows, because their parents are always trying to give each child its own knowledge, so it has its own place in the world. So but a very interesting way of living in diversity, giving everybody its own knowledge so they can give its own contribution to the world, and to the world functioning, and they are also very respectful for the knowledge of other people. And that makes it sometimes difficult to think about knowledge dialogue and the construction of knowledge together, as you pointed out. So the same knowledge is not possible in this context. And well, the first time we were confronted with this, was when they tried to train local teachers, indigenous teachers. And there were people from nine different ethnic groups together, from nine different people, nine different languages. And it was very difficult to construct something together. It was almost impossible. So everybody has to do its own curriculum. They have to make their own material. There's a, so this diversity is making itself work. And it's fascinating to see how knowledge is not universal. It's universal in a very abstract sense, but it has its particular expressions in this world, which makes it so fascinating.
Yeah, but
yeah, Fernando too.
Yeah. Knowledge is not universal, of course. But in what you are saying, there is a power differential, a distinct power differential I have to mention. Because one of the things is the diversity of the knowledge, let's say, in the forest, and the other is the knowledge of the botanist. So that is past universal knowledge. Mm-hmm. And what Abel is bringing here is showing us that that is not universal knowledge. So, but we still are in that kind of power differential. And I think that's beautiful, that kind of painting situation that Marisol is doing. We are still kind of here in the side of the dominant knowledge. So that is the question that I think we have to confront. What do we do now that we know what we know in relation to what Abel and the people that other knowledge?
We have a quick question there. By the way, Fernando Arias is the artist who produced the video, and tomorrow he's going to keep on illuminating us from all your perspectives. Fernando, I wanted to say something.
Well, maybe more like anecdotic story. When I went to the Amazon, when the Prince Klaus also asked me to do a video, a little bit justifying why Abel Rodriguez is going to be given this super prize, which normally is given to artists. And when I met Abel, I knew he wasn't an artist, and I confronted him with this, and you can see what he answers me. Because I didn't know who Abel Rodriguez was. I'm an artist myself. And I went to meet him. He looked to me from head to toe, and he's like, you know, who are you? Anyway, he accepted that we will go to the Amazon to do this. And there were like 2 or 3 days, he didn't really speak a word. So I was with the cameraman, the sound, and we were like, what are we going to do? Abel is not really giving us any of his knowledge. And one of the things maybe that really struck me is like when I asked him, who do you want to pass this knowledge, all this knowledge that people are talking about you and to? And he said, I don't have anyone to pass it on. And I'm not going to pass it to anyone. So that sort of stayed with me. That goes a little bit back to the question of Walter at the beginning, who said, what do we do with what I know? It's got lots of knowledge, but we don't know it. So what do we do with what? With Abel? You know, we are putting Abel in these situations that he now goes internationally, like as an artist, as one can tell that I knew about some sort of like decline in the, for example, in the quality, and I'm very critical here. But it's us who are making this to happen, you know? It's us, the art world, the market, paying lots of money for this. So I don't know, I have a doubt with that of this price, but I just wanted to share with you.
Great. No, gracias.
So when I say divergence, I mean a relationship that doesn't, that is not articulated by our differentials. But I don't mean either a situation where the relation of divergence is only articulated by power differentials. So I agree that science and botany has historically acquired the power to be knowledge and dismiss other practices from the qualification of knowledge. But that doesn't mean that the historically acquired power of botany to dismiss other knowledges presents itself all the time when there is a relationship between, let's say, botany and knowledges that have been denied the quality of knowledges. So I think that it is a very complex situation where it's not either or, and where, of course, power has to be acknowledged, and power is being exercised in this room as well, right? But we have to, your question has to do with that. What do we do with this prize that Aben has, we are putting Aben in the situation in which he is made responsible of. And it's not only Aben that's being put in the situation of being responsible of, it's us also that are being put in the situation of being responsible for the kind of knowledge and the relationships of knowledge that we enact. And that's why I wanted to bring attention to the relationship that has produced this event, including Miguel, and to demark the responsibility that you have pointed out that Abel has been imposed, in a sense, and to assume the relationship as a possibility of sharing the burden of de-universalizing knowledge and perhaps rescuing botany from being an imperial practice. I think it can be rescued from being an imperial practice, and it has to be rescued from being an imperial practice, but it is our responsibility to do that. And I don't think it's as simple as granting the status of knowledge to that which imperial knowledge has denied the status of knowledge. I think it's more complex than that. It is creating relationships between different practices that undo the power relation. So I think that Walter's question, what we do now that we know, has to do with how do we practice that which we know now that we know. It is our responsibility, and it's not only the responsibility of making visible other knowledges, it is our responsibility to practice our knowledge in a different way. And that's super hard.
Thank you, Arturo. Arturo.
Yo no sé hacer un aporte a la conversa. Uno, en términos de esa pregunta constante que vos tenés acerca de qué hacer, ¿no? ya sabemos que existen las relaciones, ya sabemos o tenemos una vaga idea de cómo es la construcción del conocimiento desde esa otra villa. Y allí salía un escenario muy particular y es que el conocimiento está sujeto a un reconocimiento. El conocimiento está sujeto a ser como inmortalizado por un reconocimiento de un estatus quo al cual nosotros pertenecemos. Yo pensaría que sí, simplemente por el hecho de tener la nobleza de reconocer que existen otras formas de pensar y de ordenar el mundo. Yo pensaría que sí, por el simple hecho de tener la posibilidad de que en un espacio como este se esté reconociendo al otro como un interlocutor válido en la construcción completa y dinámica que es el estar compartiendo un espacio pequeñito en el universo que se llama Tierra. Y tengo una anécdota, no es una anécdota, es simplemente una historia que comparto yo con un pueblo que además conoce de otra vez. Y es que ellos comparten su conocimiento en un constante trasegar. Sí, es trasegar, se va construyendo uno a uno. No se casa con su propio pueblo. Es una regla fundamental de su existencia. Son exogámicos. Eso garantiza que tú vas a entregar lo que tú tienes en tu mochila, en tu ser, y garantiza que el otro va a ser lo mismo con el propio, y va a ser complementario. De esa manera se va ordenando y cuidando lo de él. Aún cuando las historias son diferentes, aún cuando la apropiación del territorio es diferente. Existe la relación de poder frente a los conocimientos. ¿Qué hacer? Diría en este momento de una manera muy rápida, fugaz, pero vehemente, desde un país que lo he vivido y me he trasladado poquito, pero he logrado trasladarlo, y es garantizar que gente como Abel, gente como los Tumú, gente que está en este momento viviendo su realidad propia, siga viviendo. Que no sean eliminados literalmente por un conocimiento y por un estatus que ve en el otro simplemente una amenaza a su propia existencia y su propia producción de conocimiento. Y es garantizar desde la academia, desde estos espacios, desde la gente que tiene el poder de escribir libros, de poner su palabra, pero es urgente. Es ya. Estamos perdiendo el territorio, estamos perdiendo nuestros miedos, porque la misma gente le da vergüenza ser, le da vergüenza ser indio, le da vergüenza hablar, le da vergüenza aprender lo que saben ellos, lo que han trasegado. No es fácil de aprender, eso es cierto, pero no se puede perder porque estamos perdiendo la diversidad de mundos, las formas de organizar, de administrar, y eso se remite a los recursos, se remite a las ideas, se remite a la política, se remite a la salud, se remite a la pervivencia del ser humano. Es eso. Sí. Y la pregunta para mí se vuelve vital por la situación que viene, es una Colombia como la que yo he vivido, es que estamos dejando morir esta gente. Ya estamos dejando morir ningún oyente sin ni siquiera mirar y darles el valor que tienen como gente, como pueblo y como conocimiento en sí.
Hey, Fernando. Tomorrow, Fernando Restrepo also will speak in the workshop. Then please come.
Otro lado, el espíritu de colabor, que es las cosas más difíciles, pero con todo lo que se ha dicho, varias cosas, unos cuatro puntos, a ver si soy capaz, ¿no? Si es así, capaz, vamos a intentar. Bueno, comenzando con English, ¿no? ¿Are you following okay? Those of you in English, are you following okay? Bueno, comenzando con lo que decía Fernando, ¿no? De Fernando
Arias,
cineasta. Me pregunto si no ayudaría, puede que no, porque empezamos mañana, hacer una distinción entre un conocimiento que se pierde y una forma de conocer que se pierde. Perder una forma de conocer conlleva perder todo un mundo. Es el punto precisamente que decía María Clara. María Clara preguntaba cómo el conocimiento es vivido en estos mundos, de tal forma que haga que esos mundos funcionen. Entonces, cuando, y esto nos enseña, digamos, también la persona como Maturana, el Maturana Varela, son mundos en que hay una, ellos lo llaman, continuidad interrumpida entre el ser, el hacer y el conocer. Y en la narrativa de Don Abel, eso es lo que es la respuesta que le daba preguntas a los sonidos, es todo el mundo, es decir, uno lo parcela, pero se parcela de otras formas, muy diferentes. Bueno, esa es la primera parte. La segunda parte es romper la totalidad del conocimiento por medio de romper la idea de naturaleza. Breaking down the totality of knowledge by breaking down the idea of nature. Eso nos lleva a la idea de la vida. La idea de la vida impresionante, estamos otra vez hablando de la vida. ¿Hace cuánto no hablamos de la vida? 200, 300 años, yo no sé, hace muchísimos años, dentro del sistema de la humanidad, por lo menos. Se hablaba de otras cosas, de la naturaleza, de supuestas huevadas, de los arcanicos, de esas.
Translation of huevada.
Y también el construir uno a partir de los muchos. Construir de nuevo un mundo a partir de todos los muchos mundos. Entonces la pregunta para mí es, ¿cómo construimos conocimiento a partir de la vida sin que sea conocimiento como lo conocemos? Te voy a hacer en inglés que lo como noté. How do we not make knowledge as usual out of life? O podemos decir, ¿cómo hacemos conocimientos para el universo? Sería otra forma de decirlo. Más allá de construir, de volver a caer en la trampa de construir naturaleza, un conocimiento a partir de naturaleza. Porque se me hace cuando hablamos otra vez de environmental humanities, cuando hablamos de deep knowledge, y todas esas cuestiones, lo que me imagino, eventualmente caemos de nuevo en el proyecto de construir conocimiento a través de otro modo, pero a partir de naturaleza. Volvemos conocimientos a partir de otra cosa, que vamos a llamar vida, pero que en realidad tampoco es la vida, porque la sacamos de su flujo universal, digamos. Y bueno, creo que hay otro punto, pero.
It's 8. Tomorrow we'll start at 9 a.m. I think we have a lot to take with us. To have a great dream in narration. Nos vemos mañana. Okay, you wanna close it, please. I think you will do it a much better work of closing it than me.
I think that it's very important. It's not to think about what knowledge we're using, qué conocimiento estamos perdiendo, but the practices through which we make knowledge. because it is those practices that make life. It's not knowledge that makes life. It's the practice of knowledge that makes life. It's one of the heritages when we inherit from modern forms of knowing and from the modern notion of knowledge is that it is the end product that matters. And what we're learning here, and I think what we have to rescue is the practices that make the possible life that then emerges as knowledge, that which you continue to do to make possible life. But there was something that led to the end product, and that is what we have to pay attention to. Not the end product, but the practices that make the process to get somewhere, which we call the end product, which we call knowledge. And that's what I want. I think that's, I completely agree with you on that. One of the few things
that you agree. Okay, muchas gracias. See you tomorrow. 9 a.m.
Okay. Ooh.